అధీప్సితార్థ సిద్ధ్యర్థం పూజితం యస్సురైరపి సర్వ విఘ్నచ్చిదే తస్మిన్ గణాధిపతయే నమః. దుఃఖత్రయోపశమనాత్ వితన్వతే శాశ్వతం సుఖం జగతః. హరయే ధన్వంతరయే కరుణానిధయే భిషక్తమాయ నమః. యయా వినా జగత్ సర్వం మూకమున్మత్తవత్సదా యా దేవీ వాఘధిష్ఠాత్రి తస్యై వాణ్యే నమో నమః. వెరీ గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ టు వన్ అండ్ ఆల్. The topic today given to me is the clinical approach with purely on the basis of Ayurveda. So on contemplating with this matter issue, I just chanced upon a very very famous cartoon of R.K. Lakshman, and this has nothing to do with the seminar topic, right? Because it happened to be checking the pulse, but I want to project it in a different perspective. Like, it was in the eons when this cartoon was written, the topic selected was because of overcrowded hospitals. The doctor was not able to recognize who is the patient. So he's searching the patient, recognizing the pulse. So I don't want to project the same kind of image towards you, but Ayurveda physician presently, we are also in the same confusion as the doctor was then, but not in the same position as such. What's the confusion we are is, whom to see, what to see, and what we are seeing. Is it the right thing what we are seeing? Now we encounter with all the medical terminologies. To speak, we are overcrowded with the medical terminologies, and all these terminologies are generated by modern science. And that terminologies which they generate and the research data which they publish, the statistical methodologies which they follow, we are also overloaded our brains with those information, and we are seeing the patients, but we have lost what to see, whom to see, and how to see. How Ayurveda proposes a physician to look at, what is the perspective Ayurveda wants a physician, Vaidya, to look at in a patient, in the nature, in the diagnosis, and how he has said to scheme your treatment is a big question among us. And what we have led to eventually is this is what we represent now. The mirror is the health system, the cat which is seeing is Ayurveda system, and what we are seeing in the mirror is not the Ayurveda system but the modern system. It is just simulates the condition that a cat, when it's look its face in a mirror and imagines itself as a lion. Can this exist, or can it lead to a successful pathway for Ayurveda, is the greatest question we encounter, and that is what we need to answer for the present world now. Ayurveda is good in its own system, in its own ground. Modern science is best in its own ground, but what we need is mutual respect, not Ayurveda person disguising a modern science. So the biggest question an Ayurveda physician has to contemplate presently is, what an Ayurveda physician has to see, and if you have decided what to see, you also need to know how to see. So these two questions we need to answer presently, and for that we need to understand Ayurveda purely on the basis of Ayurveda without interspersing Ayurveda with modern science. So modern science, it's what we see, both the system, health system, visualize the human body. Both the health system sees the disease. Yes, for us, body, human body, is a contour contained by the skin consisting of the multiple system, starting from the skeletal system, musculoskeletal system, circular system, nervous system, visceral system, cerebral system, etc., multiple systems. But this system do exist, lion exist, means cat exist, but when cat sees in its mirror, it should be the cat's image which it has to see. I can't see any other image in the mirror, considering that image is better than me, and I have to see that image in the mirror which I see. Everything is best in its own ground. If we lose our ground, we don't have our ownness. That's the main thing we need to realize at this particular time. The whole body is divided into system in the modern science. We have our own kind of division, and that division, how it is based on what grounds it is being divided, how it is developed. And remember, Ayurveda is a parallel line of system. It takes both Swastha and Athura parallelly as a railway track. It never deals only with the disease. It never deals only with the impurities. It also deals how you have to be in a normal condition. So, Swastha Athura Parayanam. Hetu Linga Aushadha Jnanam Swastha Athura Parayanam. That's the reason Charaka starts with the verse, this is the Shastra which gives you the cause, the lakshanas, and the medications to continue a person to be in the swastha, or to continue for a person when it is improperly done towards the roga. So these two are simultaneously dealt, and any shloka when you read, any adhishthana when you encounter with, any person you deal with, you have to think from the time how this person was existing in swastha, or how this person has to be brought towards the position of swastha, what is this person's ground as swastha, and how it has been varied. So then, what they have been mentioned, the vikaras mentioned in our shastra is swabhavat chutaha. That's the reason. Means swabhava is the swastha, and when the person loses its natural characteristic where he is supposed to be a healthy person being, when this process of decline is called as vikara. So it is not the system which is affected. For us, everything is viewed in the perspective of doshas. And how we see it? Dosham evahi avayavaha. You say cervical system means vascular system? Yes, it exists. But how it exists? In the form of doshas. And how? Again, the contemplation should be towards the subtle nuances and the minutest. Then it goes into a pathway of Ayurveda. Until unless we see vascular means heart disease as something from the shula, or it starts from the gulma, we can't encounter or treat a cardiac illness. Until unless we see how Prameha has been mentioned in multiple grounds in Ayurveda, we cannot treat diabetes. Until unless we contemplate how hypertension has been encountered in Ayurveda, we cannot understand what is hypertension. So it is not previous one. The condition in modern science, how it has been tuned is, a person when encounters to you with the multiple reports, as the previous Lakshman's depiction, we see the report. If the person has hypertension, there is one medication for hypertension. If the person has high blood sugar levels, another medication add on for the blood sugar. If the person has hyperlipidemia along with this, then there is an add on medicine for hyperlipidemia. So one clinical condition and one medication is the motto of the present day modern science. I don't say the modern science as such, they are best in their own way, but this is the present trend which is being followed in the health system. We are also following the same kind of prescription methodology. We need now a catalog, just as the Sims, where one condition, if the patient comes with fever, we need to give a paracetamol similar medicine. If the patient comes with the upper respiratory tract infection, we need a medicine simulating the CPM, cetirizine, etc. medicine. So we are trying to equate the conditions with that of the medicines prescribed in the modern medicine, and we try to find out a medicine like histantin or whatsoever medicines available in Ayurveda, and try to simulate the kind of methodology which is being presently practiced in the health system. So I just want to show what is the aberration which is caused by such kind of methodology, and how we are moving away from the roots of Ayurveda, and what is the cause for our fall, and what is the step for our appraisal. All these are one and the same. So, as I mentioned earlier, next. As I mentioned earlier, For modern science or the present scientific methodology sees human body as a conglomeration of multiple systems. So how do we visualize a human body? This is the first thing we have to keep it. This is called as a ground knowledge based on which we can build up on, based only on which we can build up the clinical diagnosis. Without this ground knowledge behind the screen in our mind, we cannot relate what is the lakshanas, what is the lakshanas pointing out towards in our body. So the ground knowledge is how deha, how body is construed in Ayurveda. This is the greatest question. Whether they say this as a conglomeration, then why only dhatus have not been mentioned? So deha for us is a relative entity. It's a relative animate entity on the earth. So what is, whenever there is a relative entity, there should be a person which is related to another thing. So what we are related to? We are related to the Prakriti. The thing Prakriti, Ashtavida Pariksha, Dashavida Pariksha, etc. is not something what we do in the clinical things. It is something, a ground reality which doesn't come on to the clinical diagnosis. It's very difficult to assess the Prakriti. Moola Prakriti is called as Bhagavati. She is the one, the Avyakta, once from the Avyakta, when it starts manifesting, it is all the Bhagavati which manifests as Prakriti. And this Bhagavati manifests Prakriti in two different forms, one in the external world and one inside yourself as an animate being. And there is always, when there is a relative manifestation, there is always a relative influence. So we always respond to this Prakriti. And how we respond? So before going to that, that's the reason, whole of the Hetu. Hetu means the cause. The cause to be a normal person, swastha. The cause for the deviation from the normalcy, the starting of the vikara. The cause for the manifestation of disease, all these are called as Hetu. And Hetu Vishesha is the major part of your clinical diagnosis. You know how the disease has to be diagnosed? How Acharyas have said the disease has to be diagnosed. There are two important shlokas, one from Charaka, one from Ashtanga Hridaya. Ashtanga Hridaya gives a perfect combination of the triangle, how you have to understand a diagnosis. Tasmat vikara prakriti. He never says diagnosis disease. So for ourselves, keep this in our mind, either the person never diagnoses diabetes, either the person never diagnoses hypertension, either a person never diagnoses a deviated nasal symptom, means disease, or the person never diagnoses a headache. This has to be kept in your mind. The first thing is never diagnose a clinical condition. Put a cross mark to that. We never diagnose a low backache. We never diagnose a stone in your kidneys. We never diagnose a low back, means sciatica. No, we never diagnose a clinical condition. First thing is that we have three steps to be triangulized in a particular person, whether it is swastha or rogi. And the first thing is that vikara prakritihi. Never understand vikara. Don't give them this is a patient, patient of udara, this is a patient of jwara, this is a patient of, no. Every vikara has multiple prakriti, and that swabhava of the dosha avastha includes into many things which will come down later on. That has to be patternized. So it is a clinical pattern which you get and never a clinical condition. What is a clinical pattern? I will tell you later on. For example, Katigraha is a clinical condition. But this Katigraha can manifest with multiple cause Hetu Visheshas, and then you relate this clinical pattern with that of the Hetu Vishesha and what Samprapti has taken between these two, then it becomes a clinical pattern. I will give you one or two examples for that. That pattern is individualized. So first thing, first step in understanding a disease is, it's a clinical pattern or Vikara Prakriti. And this Vikara Prakriti can start for us from different Roga Margas. That's the reason we have three Roga Margas. It can start from the Koshta, it can start from the Shaka, it can start from the means Asthi Sandhi Marma. So Roga Margas mean to say this is the Margas where Dhatus or Doshas, the Srota Pravahana, Parinamam Apadhyamananam Dhatunam Vahini. These are the Srotasas which in normalcy it has to take the normal bodily elements to appropriately, but when the Vikara starts, this is the starting point of deviation. So we should know if this particular prameha has started, whether it has started from amashaya, pakvashaya, means pachyamanashaya, or from the udara samprapti during the avalambaka kapha circulation, etc. So there are lots of avastha visheshas that is happening in everyday life of ours, and which part of avastha or physiological entity does this disease starts is the most important thing. Adhishthanantarani buddhva hetu visheshamscha. And now the most important thing which we don't do, we never ask any patient what all the hetu visheshas he is involving in, whether he has vishanashana, adhyashana, samashana, what kind of food he is involved into, abhishandhi ahara, atyanta abhishandhi ahara, viruddha ahara, vidahi ahara, so many kinds of. So how does the samprapti starts in our science? Every samprapti starts with the hetu vishesha. Vidahyannam viruddham cha tattachasru pradushanam. This is in Vatarakta. Vidahi abhishandha ratasya jantoho pliha. So every disease starts from hetu vishesha, and any one of us, are we trying to elicit the hetu vishesha in a particular clinical condition? When we see a clinical condition, we forget this triangle of what we are supposed to do, a physician does. We only see the katigraha, and more that, we overlap that katigraha with that of MRI scan report. That ends our diagnosis. This is the problem, what happens to an Ayurveda physician. An Ayurveda physician, whether we are complete or not, we have to make an effort to fulfill this triangle. So, to know this vikara prakriti, we should know how body is disposed. And that's the reason I said, when the hetu starts, it divides into the inanimate person and the nature, and this has a relation. It's always the related things which goes wrong. That's the reason it starts from dhinacharya and rutucharya. Rutucharya is not something that you are supposed to do vamana in vasanta. It is not that you are need to drink some kind of paniya in grishma ritu. No. It is not that you need to do virechana in sharad ritu. No. Our body has a season, ritu. And that season maps with the external ritu. And whatever body maps with the external ritu, and that is called as swavirya, and that particular body has a predisposition for a particular disease which is caused by these rutus. That's what exactly meant by rutucharya. And that particular person should always follow the instructions given in this particular rutu. I'll give you an example. Graishmehi payo marut pittaha. A person who has a vata pitta prakriti always maps his prakriti body constitution towards that of summer. And in that particular person, in the normal avastha, when the derangement starts, the relativity of derangement yoga is always with this particular mapping. And that particular person should always have a charya almost similar to that which has been mentioned in Grishma, and he should never have a charya that has been mentioned in Varsha. So it is not that the same person should undergo the charya of Grishma in Grishma Ritu, it is same person should undergo the charya of Varsha Ritu in Varsha. No, you are troubling your body. It is a process of mapping. So always a Deha Desha maps with that of the Kala, means Dhoni Desha maps with that of the Deha Desha. And there is always a relative entity which exists. And this has been divided into two. That is the Bahiranga Hetu and Antaranga Hetu. The Desha and Kala, which forms the Bahiranga Hetu, have two kinds of presentation. One is its influences manifestation on existence of the body, as well it influences the manifestation of the disease. The existence of a body, the manifestation of body is also because of the relative influence of Deha and Desha, and the existence as well as manifestation of disease is also because of the Deha and Kala. It's a very confusing entity. Let us go on specifically. This has been classified into Bahiranga Hetu and Antaranga Hetu. Antaranga Hetu are the doshas. Doshas are the one which influence the dhatus and all the existing element in the body, and that's the reason it is called as antaranga hetu. Of this antaranga hetu, again we divided to two. One is voluntary, one is involuntary. One is svatantra, one is paratantra. All the three doshas are potential elements. They have their own viryas. That's the reason they are called as atma. They are called as atma virya. And that's the reason we get a disease entity called as nanatmaja vyadi. So they have their own kind of atma viryas, atma gunas, through which they enact in the body. And the disease which is primarily affecting this atma virya, which starts from this atma virya, are called as nanatmaja. So you don't diagnose katigraha. The katigraha can start from nanatmaja, it can start from samanyaja, it can start elsewhere in the body depending on the adhishtana, etc. Depending on the hetu vishesha, it divides into multiple. We will give one example for that. So we don't have a clinical condition. Keep that in mind. Only one thing you have to remember here from this class is that we don't have a clinical condition. So there is an atma virya and atma. That's the potential energy of these doshas inside our body. And this atma virya, again, the doshas are classified into two depending on their energy types. Doshas are potential as well, only vata is kinetic. So every dosha has its own power, but only in its sthana. And the movement which for these doshas from one place to another, and the energy samvahana in the body, the shakti samvahana, or whatever the movement which is necessary, or the kinetic force necessary in the body. The kinetic force is the life. Without kinetic force, it's called as panchatvam. Everything exists, but there is no kinetic force, then it becomes panchatvam upagamyate. Then we are dead. So that kinetic force is the dosha. So now we have to know there is a bahiranga hetu, there is an antaranga hetu. In the antaranga hetu pradhanam, there is only two doshas, which are three. All the three doshas are potential. Of this potential, only vata is kinetic. That's the reason why vata is called as vayu, is called as vibhu, and so importance is given to vayu. And now, this doshas is for disease or swastha, it's always an external influence. And there is two kind of influence. One is desha and kala is a relative influence, because a person, what he is existing is the desha. This desha is called as deha desha, is a manifestation from bhumi desha, what we start called avyakta, mahan, ahankara, etc., etc., you all know. And again, it is having a temporal influence, that is a kala, and this temporal influence is of two types in Ayurveda. What are those? Kshanadihi vyadhyavastacha. So you have an influence which is called as rutu, mean to say a person maps with a particular rutu. Then vyadhyavastha, depending on the dosha avastha, multiple clinical patterns manifest in the body. So these two has to be simultaneously understood. So when an Ayurveda physician sees a person, what you have to keep in mind? There is a bahiranga hetu influencing the antaranga hetu. What you are assessing is the antaranga hetus. These antaranga hetus are always related to two factors, the desha and kala. This desha and kala is always overlaps or relatively exist with that of the bahiranga desha and kala. And most importantly, what are the two elements which affects this to exist, means which takes this and the swastha or pulls this towards aro, means atura, is the two factors, ahara and vihara. So that again comes under the bahya hetu. So all these elements you have to simultaneously see in a patient when he comes to your clinic. Never see MRI image. Never see only katigraha. Never see only the complaints he is giving. No, this is not your perspective. Complaints are what they say. But what we need to know is how to elicit this to the spectrum of these complete diagnostic elements which has been mentioned in Ayurveda. Next. So what happens when we see the last part as a tip of iceberg, that is the lakshanas. So what are the things preceding this, how to presume this? Both the things we need to answer. So the first thing is ahara vihara. A swastha or a person who has a natural predisposition towards a desha and kala, who has an antaranga hetu, is always predisposed to bahiranga hetu, and the bahiranga influencing bahiranga hetu is always ahara and vihara. Whatever kind of ahara he involves, that's the reason it starts. Every samprapti you take and start, see, it starts with a bahiranga hetu. That's what I said. Vidahyannam viruddhamcha, vidahya bishyandarato jantoho. Everything, it starts with a bahiranga hetu, and there are multiple types of bahiranga hetu, and there is a prototype how this bahiranga hetu influence creates a ripple effect in the body. What we are creating is a ripple effect. It starts the effect in one particular place, either depending on the kavaigunya, it can be in the amashaya, pachamanashaya, etc. It can be in the avalambaka kapha, in the phasamprapti of udara. It can be in the dhatus, it can be in the asandhyasthi marmas. Anywhere, depending on the kavaigunya, it can start. And whenever it starts, if you are continuing involvement in the vahara vihara, it starts the ripple effect. One after the other things are getting involved. Ultimately, it becomes a complex disorder. So ahara vihara, the first thing. So whenever a patient comes to you, what are the things you have to ask? I'll just tell you in fast short. What time you wake up? You have your breakfast early in the morning or before bowel evacuation, after bowel evacuation. Do you get appetite before you are having food? Do you have any kind of problems in all these navarangras? That's the reason Navegandharani Adhyaya, how many of you elicited? That is our clinical diagnosis. Ask everything what are existing, then you know how the relatively they are existing in our clinical manifestations. So that is in short, you just ask all the symptoms which is existing, kasa, shwasa, kshavatu, penasa, ajirna, udgara, all these things, asana gulma lakshanas, or all the vegadhyayas. When you ask, you will know how relatively you can assess the clinical condition. And after that, what time he has his dinner, when he sleeps, after having food, whether he sleeps or not, whether he drinks milk, if he drinks milk, what time he drinks milk, whether he takes curds, if he takes curd, how regularly he takes curd, whether he eats previously cooked food, whether he eats, cooks food, keeps in refrigerator and eat it for long time, parushita annam, atyagnim, it's the first cause for which disease. Only when you relate such so, then you will be able to diagnose very perfectly and specifically. That is the first parushita atyagnim. Is the cause for? Very good. Vidradi. How it happens? You might not see Vidradi practically, but that samprati is occurring in this particular body. That's how you have to relate clinically. So take all these causes which has been mentioned in, ask them, make a rapid fire round, ask the patient, note it down, then comes, ask your koshta, note it down, then assess the agni. Atyagni is not a good sign, means all the time when a patient has good appetite, that doesn't mean to say it's a normal agni. When you only say, do you have good appetite? Yes. Do you get digestion nicely? Yes. That doesn't mean to say agni is normal. Only relatively when these conditions exist, agni is a relative entity. When the previous entity and the purva apara yojana is proper, then only agni is diagnosed. It is not only by questioning whether you have good appetite, whether you have good digestion, you can diagnose the agni. No, it cannot be diagnosed. So when you know the proper diagnosis, you know how the agni can vary with presenting itself normally. It's a very tricky thing, agni, which presents itself normally most of the times, but it is abnormal under the surface. So that under the surface is what we need to understand. And after that, relate the lakshanas, whatever is getting to this, how you are going to relate is the samprapti. See, I will tell you one thing, what we people do wrong is, we always say vataja katigraha, kafaja katigraha. We always say vataja prameha. What acharyas meant by this is the greatest question we have to contemplate. Acharya never said so. He never said, vikara, vata means dosha doesn't exist in your vikara. My way of presentation is different. Mean to say, vikara itself, in the sutrasthana, first chapter itself, he said, swabhavat chutaha vikaraha. Whenever the dosha leaves its swabhava, goes to a different swabhava, that is vikara, then how can you give the same name to that? You can't give it. But Acharya gives that with a tantra yukti associating, three tantra yukti he associates. One is ekanta, anekanta. Second one is atita vekshana, anagata vekshana. Know the previously what he mentioned by doshas. He says atita vekshana. What I mentioned by vata here, I have already said in sutrasthana that it has lost its swabhava. Then vikaras I have mentioned in anagata vekshana, vikaras I have mentioned in sampraptis. Relate that with that of swabhava. And then anekanta never makes idamittam. Only this and not that is the ekanta. That only happens in your bhakti yoga. I am bhavantam ekantam yantam artham. He says you can only go to God with one mind. Bhavantam ekantam yantam artham. That's the only path where you have to have an ekanta tantra yukti. But doesn't happen in Arudha Shastra. Never say Katigraha, you say IVDP is the cause for this Katigraha. No, it can never happen in Ayurveda. There is no Ekanti. He says, we always have to know the other ways of manifestation. And that other ways of manifestation, all things, how do you relate? When they say Vataja Katigraha, you have to relate from the Ahara Vihara till the Samprapti. And how you are going to relate, it's a very detailed thing which I cannot explain in half an hour or 1 hour. This samprati again has just been mentioned in the whole of 16 chapters of Nidanasthana. How he divides? How the whole of the disease is divided? It's divided into two polarities. Rendu dhruvangalanu. It divides into two polarities. This can happen in this way or the other way. Katigraha. It can either happen in the nanatmaja pattern or samanmaja pattern. This is the first step you have to understand. Decide whether it is in the nanatmaja pattern. How you decide? It's a very elaborate procedure. How you decide whether it is in samanmaja pattern? First thing is that's the reason Charaka says Charake dvividha rogaha samanyaja nanatmadashchet. Katigraha can come next. In samanyaja, nanatmaja I am not going to deal it now. In samanyaja it can come in these many colors. In jwara you find katigraha. Do you find katigraha or not? Yes. In anaha? Yes. In arshas? Yes. In grahani? Yes. Then in pakvashoga talata? Yes. Then when the person comes to you with MRI scan and IVDP, how can you skip all these things and say it is katigraha? Can you say it or not? Yes or no? Louder. No, you cannot say. A person with 3rd degree spondylolisthesis can come with any kind of this. You treat this. This is what has been mentioned for us. That has not been mentioned for us. You can use it as a supportive element, not as the primary element. I'm not against any investigative methodologies. I'm not against any modern technologies. But what I say is be yourself. The Indian mind need to think purely Indian. You think in your own ground. Respect the other things and you see how you will grow. So it is not a thing of methodology, means it's not a thing of thinking, it's always a perspective that matters. They might be 100 steps ahead of us, but we are in first step, we need to keep the second step, not the 100th step. That's the most important thing we need to keep. So katigraha can be the manifestation of these many sampraptis. Now, any dosha can enter into this samprapti, right? What's the basic difference between nanatmaja and samanyaja, this one disease is? Nanatmaja is, that's what I said earlier, relate back. The Atma Virya is lost. The Swavirya is lost. And then Samanyaja is, there a dosha due to Bahiranga Hetu gets involved into a particular samprati, goes into this Gati Dosha Gati Amumashaya Mashritya Doshaha Ittam Gataha Swayam Dushyani Evam Vikurvanto. What all the samprati which is mentioned in is what is for the doshas. The doshas are in samanya vyadi because of vidahi ahara, the pitta in the pakvashaya turns into accha pitta, turns into amla pitta. This will generate the symptoms of amla pitta like burning hearts or burning belchings, etc. When this enters into rakta, it causes prayaha pitta shleshmalehi prayo raktam pradushyate. It will cause rakta dushti. Once rakta dushti happens, then it can start manifesting the rakta dushti lakshanas. When this enters into marmas, then it becomes a vata rakta. When this enters into shakas and tvang mamsara samashritaha, it becomes to manifest into sagasarpa. See, the start, it starts from that of the grahani, pachananashriya. What makes it to start is the vidahi ahara. I am giving only unilateral thing. This will not happen like this, only multiple things mix with this. So vidahi ahara is the one, or vidahi swabhava is the one which turns the accha pitta in the grahani to amla pitta. That amla pitta enters into rakta. It might enter, it might not enter. It stand as amla pitta lakshanas only. But later on, eventually the ripple effect can enter into rakta. The ripple effect can enter into rasa. this rakta will again can manifest depending on the kavalgunya. It can go and stay in the marma, which can cause vatarakta. It can go and stay in the tvang mamsa. It can cause visarpa. Visarpa is not herpes. You are in clinical case, half the conditions you get is visarpa. Please keep this in mind. Only when you know the visarpa swabhava, you can understand. It can turn into udarda, and it can go into uras. It can cause uro abhishyanda or uro vidarda. It could go into shakhas and marmas, the sandhis. It can cause vatarakta. So vatarakta is not diagnosed based on RA factor. It is not diagnosed based on ASO or CRP. It is diagnosed based on this dosha gati or the samprapti. This is what you have to keep in mind. I can't make you understand within 1 hour how to understand each and everything. But one thing you have to understand is, it is not diagnosed based on the investigative reports. It is diagnosed based on your, not even on your uha. This is again one more thing point which I have to say. Don't create things. Whether Shastra gives you the power to create things, he never gives. He says, Chikitsita midam kuryat uha apoha vikalpavit. A person comes to us with a low back ache. I think it might be low back ache, katigraha. Might be we will start with that of katigraha chikman. No, you don't have that right to do. He says, uha, you have to think, make a probable diagnosis only if you have the enough knowledge to reach towards a definite diagnosis. Apoha vikalpavit. There are 7 gunas to buddhi. Uha and apoha are the 5th and 6th gunas of buddhi, where he says you can give a creative thought to a mind only when you know the definite thought. You have to reach. So katigraha I know, but I can give a creative thought. I have to pass through all these sampraptis only when I know how I can reach definitely. It is not because of twara, it is not because of ajina, it is not because of anaha. It is the pakvashayagata vata which is causing this particular katigraha. Otherwise, you are not supposed to go for trial and error methodology. So trial and error methodology is not advocated in Ayurveda science. This is one thing which we have to keep. So all the research methodology, let me try this. Let me see how it is effective. Let me say this. It's not advocated in Ayurveda. If you are trying this, you should know what I am trying, where I am trying, how I am trying, and whether my trial is supported by the Shastra. Otherwise, you are not supposed to do that. This is one thing an Ayurveda physician has to keep in your mind. So this one way, so now the doshas can enter into ajirna, and now ajirna, and that can manifest itself as katigraha. This one particular thing we will take next. How doshas enter? And so I'll come back to the next step. So I just mentioned about the triangle, how we are going to diagnose vikara prakriti, adhishtana and hetu vishesha. But this will not have an uniform kind of response in each and every person. For example, a person who is diabetic. Imagine a person who is diabetic at the age of 40, mother, wife is also diabetic. The child may get diabetes at the age of 20. How it happens? So, the person developed diabetes at the age of 40. How can the child develop diabetes at the age of 20? Multiple factors involved. Might be because of the ahara and viharas the person is involving and the child is involving. Second thing is, if it is not an external influence, there is always a swaviriyaha. The two kind of effects which the body responds is always swaviriya and ahara virya. The ahara and vihara which we get from the external is always influencing the swaviriyaha. And the person's swaviriya, now what predominates is always the ahara virya. If the person has the swavirya to fight with the external forces, then the person overcomes the external force. But the external forces is greater than the swavirya, then body gives up. Body succumbs to disease. So ahara virya and swavirya should be simultaneously assessed. How is this person genetically disposed with all the kind of food habits he is involving into, and how the food habits can influence a particular person differs. And again, it's always played with the divine force called as adrishta hetukena karmana, praktana karma. This is the only element the basic element, the unexplainable abstract element seen only in Ayurveda and no other health sciences mentions this. A person succumbs to a disease, roga, shoka, paritapa, bandhana, vyasananicha. These five factors a person undergoes in his life, the roga, shoka, paritapa, the relations we are into, vyasanas, all these habits, etc., are not decided by your buddhi. Your buddhi can control it and we can come out of it with our buddhi and manas, but it is not decided by our buddhi or our voluntary thing. It is always atma parada vrikshanam phalani yetani dehinam. The deeds or the karmas were done by the atmas are seen in these five elements over the body. So this element a physician has to keep in his mind. So how many things now he has to keep? If you point out, when you see one patient, you have these many points under the ground. These points will not be seen on the surface. What you see on the surface is katigraha. It can be vataja katigraha, kafaja katigraha. You can see on the surface prameha. You can see on the surface pushta. And all these things which I said is under the surface, without keeping these under your mind, we cannot reach a technical Ayurveda diagnosis. This is the point where we are going wrong. And modern methodology, random control trial, double blindness, this methodology cannot be applied to our science because of this particular conceptual knowledge. And there is no better sign for a perfect diagnosis than the pure conceptual knowledge. So, now, keep this apart. We said multiple samprapti can lead to katigraha, like anaha, ajina, etc. Now, doshas, these are all the samanaja samprapti. I never touch into Nanatmaja, it's a completely different entity and it's a very small entity now encountered in clinically. What the basic thing what you encounter, even in Vata Vyadi, it comes through Samanya Samprati. Pakshagata, you go and see where and all. Other than Vataja Vyadi, you find Pakshagata. Then you take this as an assignment and go and see how Pakshagata can manifest, how many types of Pakshagata you can get. So it is not just Vata Vyadi. It manifests as Vata Vyadi. Of course, at a point of time, the trained basic line of treatment is Vata Vyadi, but the process of manifestation is multiple, and that process of manifestation is what you need to treat. And now coming to Katigraha, we said Ajirna can cause Katigraha. We will go only for that particular part of Katigraha. How this Ajirna can manifest? Now the doshas should lose from its Swabhava to start a Vikara. And how it loses, it can lose in the koshta in three formats. This is all again broad classification. How? In the amashaya, it can be ama. Pachyamanashaya, it can be vidahi. In the pakvashaya, it can be vishtambi. Now doshas, vata or pitta or kapha can enter into any of these things. Right? Ama vata, sama pitta, sama kapha. Right? The lakshanas for those have been mentioned separately. This can enter any of the pattern in the ajirna. And then this can enter into any samprapties and can be in different avasthas. Again, the doshas which enter into these three kind of samprapti patterns. Now see how many probabilities you are getting. They can exist in avasthas. That is what you see in Nidanasthana. What you see in Nidanasthana is not the disease. He shows how in the Sutrasthana, he has given how the digestion occurs. And whenever there is a variation in digestion, what and all things can get transformed into either into ama or into vidhagda or into vichchamba, etc. It's been mentioned in Sutrasthana, in Matrashiti Adhyaya, etc. And now from this you have to take it into some practice of Nidhanasthana. How it can happen? It can stay in the Utklishtavastha, it can stay in the Leenavastha, it can stay in the Sodarada Pinasashvasa, Udrikta Avastha. So many avasthas have been mentioned in the Nidanasthana. Now relate this with that Yoga Tantra Yukti, Padanam, Eka Eka Inam, Artha Auchityena Yojanam. This you have to do. And now, one particular thing is these avasthas can be in koshtas or in srotas. Now Roga Margas came into existence. They can stay in the koshtas or they can go in for the other margas. See how many multiple things you have to think next. Oh God, next. Coming back, yes. With one example of ajirna, katigraha is a manifestation. how these doshas, katigraha can be the manifestation. You also need to strike the other lakshanas, what is manifesting along with this. So we started from doshas, how the swabhava has lost from doshas, it can lose where in the koshta, it can lose, and how many types can be manifested in that. This can enter into any kind of samprapti, which through the ajina samprapti, and this samprapti can be placed in any kind of three roga margas or any particular part or more than one part. And then let's see this shloka. Tasya lingam ajirnasya vishtambaha satanam tata. It can cause as shiroruk cha murcha cha brahmaha. The moment you get hypertension, why do you start bypassing? It can be in this way. Means if it is in this way, ashtachurna or vaishvandra churna or chiranilvadi will work. If it is not in this way, it will not work. This is the thing I am telling you. Brahmaha. Pushtah katigraha, it can cause this katigraha, it can cause jrimba. Jrimba is a very important clinical thing which needs a long explanation. Angamardaha, trishna. Again, trishna is not the first you are thinking. Jwaraha, chardihi, pravahanam, arochako, avipakascha, ghoram, anna visham chachetat. This is the lakshanas of ajirna. Along with this, depending on which doshas it has been affecting, it can go in for samsrujjamanam pittena. It can cause daham, trushna, mukhamayan, janakti, amnapittam cha, pitta jamscha, aparan, gadan. Yakshma penasa meha din. Note, prameha can be because of ajirna. When you see blood sugar level, do you think this? This is the one the question. So if it is in this pattern, the diabetes has manifested, chiruvilvadi kashava will work. Otherwise, nishakatakadi will not work. If it is not in this way, Nishakatakadi also will not work. Again, Chiruvilvadi also will not work. This is what I said. There is no diabetes and treatment for diabetes. Treatment is always for avastha anuvidhanam. Ekshma penasa mehadin kafajan kafasangatan karoti vata samsrushtam vata jamscha aparan gadan. Whatever vata disease you find in vatajan anatmajavadi, you also find in this particular context. Think before you treat. Yes. Mutra rogamscha mutrastam kukshi rogan shakrudgatam rasadibhischa samsrushtam kuryat rogan rasadijan. So he gives again. You have to go see somewhere else. So this many kind of manifestation you have to keep in your mind. So I came back. Ekshma, this is one of the method of manifestation for diabetes. Next slide. Okay, this is a ripple. Next slide. Yes. So let us see how diabetes has been mentioned in our sins. So all these things which I said in my mind previously has to be kept in mind. Along with this, I told kafaja ajirna also can lead in towards the manifestation of meha. And then there is one particular important thing. Sushita gives, after this we'll conclude, he says, Kushteshu meheshu kafamayeshu kushatva michatsucha medhureshu. And then he also gives of sthaulya yoga niman. This kind of yogas have advocated for all these disease. Then he gives a common ground of treatment for kushta, meha, kafamaya, sthaulya, sarvanga shofi cha medhureshu. Sarvanga shofa. Mean to say what? Think the arthapatti tantra yukti. Kushta can have a swabhava of meha. Sastula can have a swabhava of meha. Then sarvanga shofa can have a swabhava of meha. Or meha can be answered with, means other way, meha can have a samsarga with that of sarvanga shofa. Meha can have a samsarga with that of kushta. All these things has a common line of approach. So it is not just as Nishamalaki, not just as Nishakatakadi, not just Katakakadiradi, there is a common ground. So we had doshas, how the doshas vary, depending on that, there is a koshta samprapti. If it is a koshta samprapti, it can go in for ajirna, that also can manifest as meha, or else it can be anywhere else the samprapti goes, it has five grounds we have to commonly think along with. And that five ground always, it is an effect of various pathological patterns influenced by individual predisposition. That till now the samprapti, everything is common, again having multiple nuances. And then when it comes to a particular body, individual predisposition should always be included in that. And that individual predisposition has been classified into two entities. One is koshta and one is agni. And all these are encapsulated into one thing influenced by three external factors. And that is ahara virya, svavirya, adrishta, hetukena, karmana. So all these things you have to keep in your mind before you diagnose a diabetes mellitus. So better don't diagnose diabetes. Diagnose always the samprapti. Next. So in the same way, this is one example for Hetu Vishesha. We don't have time to get into that. Next. Again, this we don't have time to get into. I'll just give a fine thing. Agni, when I said Agni is not simply Agni, even it can, under the surface, it can show multiple things. We'll just go through Raukshat Mande Agnaho. What is the condition? Sarpihi Tailam Va Deepanihe Pram. Snehati Panat Mande Agno. When the Agni is Snehati Pana, and Snehati Pana here is Tantra Yukti Upalakshana, it is not just the Sneha Ghrita what you are going to take. Sneha is a samprapti in your body which is happening. This is a particular type of samprapti. Ruksha and Sneha are sampraptis. And Sneha Atipanat means when this samprapti becomes superfluous, then what is the treatment? Kshara Chona Asava Arishta. Udavartat Mande Agno Niruha Sneha Vastayaha Doshati Vridha Mande Agno. Again it has Dosha Nirharana. Srote Vibande Mande Agno Kshara Chona. It comes in what? Shothadikara. Ama Guru Upalepat Vibadda Vit. When you do Koshta assessment, you need to know how the wit is. Whether it is Ama, Guru, Vibhadda, with Sashleshma, Sarakta, etc. It is not simply writing constipation. Patient, do you have good bowel evacuation? Yes, they say yes. But when you ask whether it is pasty or hard or bowly, then they say it is pasty. 2-3 times. It goes, but how it is going, that is also important. Okay? Dhinna Guda Koshtattu Male, Sura Asava Lavana Ghrita has to be given. Manda Agnim Krura Koshtamsa, Kshanam Chudipaniyam Param. Vyadhimukta sarpurevatu deepa means deepanam. Then samshodhana, peya, etc. Has to be done, etc., etc. So with one entity of mandagna itself, we get multiple clinical patterns. So all these things has to be appropriately collaged. Instead of collaging our system with that of modern technical terms, collage our diagnosis with that of our terminologies. Next. This is the only thing I want to say. And with the last sentence from Hitopadesha, he says, Eda shakyam, natat shakyam, et shakyam, shakyam evatat, nodake shakatam yati nacha naur gacchati sthale. Because there is a very beautiful saying that the vehicle, motor vehicle cannot go in water and the boat cannot run on road. The similar way, we cannot treat the path of modern medicine, neither modern medicine can treat the path in our system. So we need to move in our own road pathway, and when we know that, we will be successful to the core. And one famous saying from Professor B.M. Hegde, today diagnosis has become a disease itself. Treating a sick person as a whole person is an old concept even in Western medicine. In the olden days, thanks to the high-tech new Western medicine of complete reductionism, whole person healing has almost disappeared from the medical student's vocabulary. The symptoms directly a huge list of investigations, and from then on, specialist treats only the reports. Please, I request all of you not to treat the reports, but to treat the whole person. Thank you. Any doubts? Welcome.